Prabjot. I work for HotelWorks, but for the Apache Zeppelin community, I am PMC and committer. I'm going to talk here about. I'm here to talk about Zeppelin and how does it connect to various interpreters, including Spark. So generally, just a word about Zeppelin. So Zeppelin is a web-based notebook that works interactively with Spark and various other interpreters. It basically allows you to connect to Scala, PySpark, or any other interpreters and help user and other, say for example, data scientist collaborate, work on a notebook, and once you have a data, provide you a visualization on top of it. That's the basic goal of it. So just like the previous session, what we saw, what happens to a typical Spark user is they have to work on a Spark shell, which at times become trivial and tricky when it comes to authentication, authorization part of it, because you have to log in into, I mean, either you install Spark on your local machine or basically log into a Spark shell or basically log into a, I mean, basically SSH into a remote machine and then get into a Spark shell. And then things goes from there. But what Zeppelin brings you is you don't really need to do SSH into a machine once you have a cluster set up already. It just connect to Spark. Authentication and authorization take care of is being taken care of with this particular thing. And all you need to worry about is the kind of query you want to run, the kind of model that you want to run on top of Spark. Not really worry about where the machine is, whether the machine is still running or not, and who's going to take care of all of those things, because the infrastructure will take care of it. Data scientist or the actual user don't need to worry about it. What we have done with the Zeppelin is we have gone ahead with this and we have merged Livy on top of it. Livy is basically a Spark job submitter. Basically, it basically manages the Spark session so that when it comes to sharing of a session, you don't really need to worry about what all sessions are there and whether someone else is also interfering with your session. That I will try and cover up in a short while. Generally, a few words about what's happening in the Zeppelin community. Last year, it became a top-level project in Apache, which was in May 2016. Prior to that, it was in incubation since March 2015. But even before incubation, Zeppelin used to exist since 2013. We are about 16 committers and more than 250 contributors that are contributing to Zeppelin. Around 2,500 Jiras have been filed. Most of them have been handled. With HotelWorks, we support about 8 to 10 interpreters, but in the community, you get 18 interpreters along with Spark, Scala, JDBC, Shell, and so on. Generally talking about the architecture, Zeppelin is a multi-level architecture where the client runs. Yes, it is the part of SDP distribution since SDP 2.5. It was since 2.4, but it wasn't GA, but since 2.5, it is GA. And we have recently announced SDP 2.6 with much more features that I will demo in a short while. So like I was saying, these are some of the interpreters that we support with HotelWorks, which is SDFS, PySpark, Spark R, Hive, Phoenix. Oh, Hive is mentioned twice, sorry about that. Shell, multiple SQLs, and so on. So the way Zeppelin works is from the front end that is running on the browser, which is HTML JavaScript, it talks via WebSocket or REST calls to the Zeppelin server, which has multiple interpreters. So we basically connect from these interpreters via TRIP protocol and execute whatever code that is that data scientist or a user wants to run, and take it from there, execute on the remote host, remote machine, or however the interpreter is running. Once the code is executed, you get the result. It is transferred back again and to the server, and via WebSocket you see it on the UI. So here are some of the Zeppelin features that I want to talk about. One is collate and load data. What you really want to do, or what user really want to do, is say multiple users are working on a big data, say GBs of data, and say some data scientist was able to compress it to few MBs. What you don't want this redundant job to do is do it again, which consumes CPU, which consumes time of the other data scientist. So you can share this data across multiple users, multiple data scientists. Second thing, the reason why you want to use Zeppelin is visualization. We support multiple visualization, and with Helium coming along, the possibilities of visualization are infinite. I mean, yes, you can use Matplotlib, the other graphing library that Python support, the other graphing libraries that R support, but for that you need a learning curve, and you don't want to typically repeat it. So what we encourage is we already have some of the basic visualization. You just feed in table. Zeppelin is able to figure out if this is a table. You probably want to visualize it as well, which makes sense to a lot of our users. The third thing that I want to talk about is collaborate. Which is around the same thing, right? Multiple people are working on the same data, and you want to have fine grain auditability on who did what, and you don't want to ruin the cluster. So Zeppelin provides those fine-grained auditability, that who did what, and that sort of a thing. Some of the popular scenarios that we have come across. While I was in Santa Clara last year, I came across a line agency that wanted to build a customized dashboard, but they weren't able to quickly do it because the technical team wasn't there. And the person that I was talking to, he was kind of techie enough, but then he didn't have proper infrastructure. So he used Zeppelin for this. He already has access to some of his database. And what he really wanted was some of his daily runout jobs, like what things are coming in, what things are going in, and then build a graph on top of it, run it a cron manner so that every day at their time, 7 a.m., things run. And things can be shared with his and his teammates. Other thing is security thing. We have just announced Apache Metron with our HDP 2.5. If you worry about security, it is pretty much taken care of. Sometime this year, early this year, I met a guy from Biocon, and he wanted to run something basically around his research. He didn't give me much details about what kind of research was it or medical trials around it. But then what he spoke to me was around, he has some of our data, but he wants to run some analytics on top of it. And he was pretty happy with what he has to do with something on Spark, which was all completely command line, versus what he can do with Zeppelin. So Zeppelin brings multi-tenancy with the interpreter called DV that I was talking about. So our main objective for this multi-tenancy is to distribute a load, right? So basically what DV does is you don't have to essentially install Spark on the same cluster. It can be on a different cluster. Yes, I do agree that Spark uses resource manager UI from Yarn, and then Yarn can distribute all of those things. But then the underlying Spark runs on the same machine. I mean, typically that's what happened. But then with Livy, Spark can be running on a different machine, which can assign resources using Yarn and then so on. But with Livy, these things become fairly easy. And then since Livy can run on a HA, you can pretty much guarantee that nothing goes down. And then obviously, since most of our customer runs Zeppelin or their cluster in a Kerberos mode, you can get a fine grain audit. You can you can pretty much guarantee what user is running on which queue, when did he run whatever job, and obviously not destroying any other's work and then not destroying any other cluster, which can typically happen if you give access to command line to any other user. So before implementing or before going out with and implementing Livy, we tried this Apache Tori as well. So the way it works is, say you have an IPython running and say multiple application running on top of it. The way Tori works is it works at the kernel level. It doesn't abstract out everything on top of it. And that is why we decided not to use this, but to use Livy for our Spark job, as a Spark job server. What it does is multiple clients can connect to Livy using REST APIs. They submit these Spark client or these clients submit jobs to the Livy server. Then I can use Scala or whatever session manager. Then these session managers talk to those individual Spark interpreter, which talks to the YARN node based on how you have configured your YARN. It could be, I mean, based on how you want your Spark to run, it could be YARN cluster, it could be YARN client, or you can go ahead and do it local, but that is not what we recommend because essentially you want to distribute the data. So the way Zeppelin and Livy interaction happens is the Zeppelin server is running on top of it. You can have configured LDAP or Active Directory or use file-based mechanism or whatever database that you want to use. It uses the Shiro mechanism to give you authentication. Once you are authenticated, Zeppelin talks to Livy using Livy Spark interpreter for authorization part of it or the authentication part of it. We use Kerberos. So for REST APIs, we use Spinego for authentication of it. So when Zeppelin talks to Livy, it uses Kerberos, Spinego, authorizes get authorization to Livy. Then Livy pass on this Spark client back to Spark and execute those things and then come back. I will give a demo of this in a short while. Little deep dive on Livy. So this is the thing that I was talking about earlier. The Livy client talks to Livy server using HTTP call. Then Livy server spawns up the RPC protocol to actually get connected to the Spark context and then execute things over there. Let me skip this and talk about how Livy actually execute codes and how do you get a session of it. So say there's a Livy client, there's a Livy server, and there's a Spark server that you want to connect to ultimately. So this is a typical curl command that that can be translated into any other API. What you do is you do a post call. You talk about what kind of session you are expecting. You can expect a Spark session, a PySpark session, or a Sparka session, depending on the usage. And then since in this Hello World example, I am connecting to a local host, port number 8998, where my Livy server is running, and get a session for it. Once a session is created, I mean, as soon as I request this particular call, it returns me that my state is running. Since I have not requested for any other proxy user, which means I am not looking for any proxy user as of now, but in my demo, I will give a demo with proxy user as well. It returns you with the kind and an ID. The ID is something that you will use it to run your actual statements or the actual code that you want to. So the way it works is Livy client requests this post call to Livy server, which then connects to the actual interactive Spark server. Once the Spark server is ready with these things, it returns back with its state that, hey, look, I am ready for whatever job that you are looking for. And then the Livy server responds this thing back to the Livy client via whatever poll APIs that, hey, look, I am ready. Do you want to submit a job? how do I execute code? It is same the post call. Instead of the previous thing where I was connecting to slash session over here, I am connecting to the slash session slash whatever ID. In this particular example, it was 0. And then statements. In this particular case, I am just trying to calculate sum from 0 to 100. So same thing happens over here. The Livy client runs this particular post call to Livy server. Livy server submits this particular thing to the Spark server with the session ID. Spark server understand that, hey, look, this is a different session or the same session based on what user has requested. Once the result is ready, it returns back it to the Livy server that here is the output, what you have requested, or error if that is applicable, and then returns it back to the Livy client. How do I get multiple sessions or multiple client talk to the same session or different session? It's based on the same magic value, which is this session ID, which is, in this particular case, session 1, the client 1 and client 2 are getting connected with session 1, and the client 3 is getting connected to session 2. Livy server understands that the call came with whatever session ID, and then gets the appropriate session, return the appropriate response back to the user. This is the same thing that I was talking about, the Livy security. The way it works between Livy, I mean client and Livy server is, the client connects to Livy via the HTTP call or the API. Livy returns it back with 401, which is authentication required. Then the client responds it back with the Kerberos ticket, which Livy acknowledges if it is correct. And then Livy server caches this particular key, uses this key to connect to the Spark session for authentication of it. So this is what I was talking about. A HTTP call that goes to Livy server via Spenego, it returns back a 401 unauthorized. Then the same client sends the same curl. For example, if I talk about in curl's language, it says curl minus minus negotiate user and whatever thing with the Kerberos ticket. So the way it happens in curl is, first you do a knit, whatever ticket and the principal. Once this is there in the session, curl uses this particular session. When I say curl minus minus negotiate, and once this authorization is successful, the Livy returns back with, okay, you are authorized and you can get me more whatever HTTP calls based on the similar protocols. This is an example where I'm trying to demonstrate how impersonation will work. And if you remember earlier, I was talking about, I went past proxy user, but I could potentially pass proxy user using the same thing. So a client can say, with the same curl thing inside the at the time of getting session, that I want to utilize proxy session, and say there were these two users called Alice and Bob. They say I want to run this particular job as Alice or as Bob, pass those things in as a proxy user. Livy understands this and then spins up the Spark shell or Spark bash job with this particular proxy user. So if a user has permission to read some of the files in SDFS system or doesn't have that, they can utilize those things. I will try and do a demo of it. Let me get into a browser. So before this, let me quickly talk about how Zeppelin is configured so that, okay, this is still running in presentation mode. Get out of it, get into a browser. No, let me change it. Let me try and change the resolution of this. Looks like it is readable, right? Or at least you can understand. So, so for authentication, this is the piece that I was talking about. This is the Shiro, Apache Shiro that we use for authentication part of it. Here I have configured it to use my local file system, where this is my username and this is my password, followed by some of the rules if I want to apply to it. However, I could use Active Directory or LDAP if required, which I have disabled as of now. And if I want some of the URLs to be, if I don't want some of the URLs to be accessed by any other user, I can restrict it within this particular block. But generally not talking about that, and then talking about what all can I configure. I can configure if my Zeppelin is running in anonymous mode or how is it. What is the connection timeout that I want to talk about? Where are my all of the interpreters kept? I could change it to whatever I want. What are the default interpreters that I want to configure in this particular notebook, if I want so. What else? My server, what is the port at which it is running or I plan to, if I want to enable SSL. If I so choose to, I may need to configure it via key store, or how do I want to actually configure it. In this particular case, I have enabled Kerberos, so what is the Kerberos in principle that I plan to use it. Log4j properties, this talks about how my log architecture is. Shiro, I already talked about it, and I mean, pretty much this is it. And then you can control, from this particular file, you can possibly control everything which is related to how much memory you want to give, how much executor you want to give, and then so on. So this was the part of where you configure Zeppelin. This is a second screen where I want to talk about the interpreter configuration. So like I was saying, Zeppelin does support multiple interpreters. This is one of the Angular interpreter. If you want to write, say, HTML or execute JavaScript on top of it, this is a generic JDBC interpreter. Over here, what I have configured is Postgres SQL, Hive SQL, and a Phoenix, which is obviously running on Kerberos mode, and Zeppelin understand these, all of these things. May need to implement different things internally to take care of the authorization part of it to run things as end user. This is a sample Libby configuration. Let me briefly talk about this as well. Same thing, and this is where my server is running, but potentially it could be running anywhere else. So if you see, this is my particular server where the Zeppelin was running, but this is where my actual Libby is running. So I can possibly control it anywhere and however I want to. So in this particular cluster, I have configured two different interpreters. One is Libby, and second thing is Libby2, where Libby2 essentially means this, or essentially means is the Libby1 is utilizing Spark 1.6.1. And Libby2 is running with Spark 2.21 or something. Okay, let me. Spark 2.1. Same thing, MD is regular Markdown language. SH is the shell interpreter. I can choose to run my shell interpreter in this particular cluster. And I have the native Spark and native Spark 2.0. And I define it with this particular Spark home and say where my local Spark will be present, and then so on. Here is one of the examples that I would look to. So this is a sample machine learning lab that I have implemented over to demo. So what I do over here is I don't have to get to a command line, run everything on this particular notebook, it has whatever data. I could potentially use multiple languages, which is I can use Spark, R, and Python on the same notebook. So this is what I have come across multiple times, that there are a lot of techies, but they do not have understanding to all possible languages. But they do understand how to Google or how to Stack Overflow. But the thing with Stack Overflow is, ask a right question, it may not return you things in a particular fashion. For example, you may want to get a particular answer, but the answer that is posted over there could be in Java, could be in Scala, could be in Python, or could have been in R, depending upon what it is. So Zeppelin allows you to share all of these answers. Sorry, please go ahead. So, Livio over here is acting as a job server for us, or in this particular case, and since Livio is working on a HA mode, which means even if Spark on one cluster is not working for either network issue or for whatever reason, Livio will ensure that my job runs. Right. Can I track the user sequence? Yes. Right. That is entirely possible. Let me show you. This is my resource manager UI. So for example, in this particular case, you can see that there was a user admin. I am logged in over here as admin. And this guy wanted to run Spark, and the Livio session was session number 5. Versus, if you see, there was a user Zeppelin, which was running as Zeppelin on whatever thing. Why don't I do this? Let me restart everything. Maybe it is already. Create a hello world. See. This will basically return me the version of Spark that is running. But since this is a simple and normal program, this will tell me. Okay, start. Take some time. And in the same time, let me go into a private mode, log in as a different user. This is now. Okay, and let me start you with user one and user one. And over here, show up as Livio session 10, and the user was user one. This would have executed, no. Do I have sufficient resource? Yes. But essentially, yes, you get the trace of all of those things. Yes, it comes with HDP. Okay. This guy failed because no application was found. But do I get trace of that over here? No. Sorry, looks like this particular job failed, and I guess that is the rule of demo, but then I can demo something else as well. So, which is fairly simple to me. Sorry? Oh, okay, possibly. Right. But then anyway, let me go ahead and run something else. let me call it user one, or let me call it admin, and say sh, and say who am I, and say what is my path. So over here, if you see, I am logged in as admin. It says I am admin, and my home directory is user/admin. Let me log out from here, and let me log in as a different user, which is user one, and run the same thing again. And when I do this, now the output changes to user one, and it says my home directory is user/user1. So similarly, the Libby works, and then it takes care of all of those sessions. It takes care of all the traces, and then so on. Apart from that, like I was talking about the other visualization part of it, let me go to something. Does this work? So over here, I am utilizing the matplotlib, but I could have used the native visualization as well. But I just wanted to demonstrate, if you choose to use native visualization, it is possible in this particular case. Or if I go to, so over here, what I've done is, I'm trying to get some data using HTTP call, convert that thing into a class, finally register as a temp table, put it into bank, and finally try to visualize it. So using Spark SQL. So if you see over here, it does understand that, so like I was saying that we have multiple interpreters, Spark, PySpark, Scala, SQL. So when I say %.sql, it understands, sorry. They both are competing in the same market, but yes, both have their own pros and cons. But yes, I agree to your point that both are web-based notebook, both support Python. Zeppelin supports a few interpreters that IPython or Jupyter doesn't, versus Jupyter also supports some of the interpreters that Zeppelin doesn't. Yes, correct. It is fairly easy. And that is why, that is what I also wanted to talk about here, but then I almost skipped it, sorry, in one of my presentation. So this is the architecture in which Zeppelin is built up. And if I talk about this particular thing, which is the interpreter group and multiple interpreters, it is, the APIs are fairly simple. And if needed, those can be implemented very easily. It is not very trivial. Let me come back to this particular thing. And like I was saying, if I execute a simple SQL query, it returns me a table. And as soon as Zeppelin realizes that, hey, look, there is a table. Do you want to do a visualization on top of it? So it gives me some of the basic visualization, where a bar chart or any other thing. Like, and then depending upon data, I can do anything on top of it. Okay, so along with Zeppelin, you do get this particular job server as well, which tells you about what are the various notebooks that are there in your cluster, and what are the status of it. So for example, if you see over here, it says a red thing, which means you were trying to execute something and it possibly failed. You click on it, it takes you back to the particular notebook and says, hey, look, this thing failed. Do you want to look at, do you want to take a look at it? I can basically go ahead and run just to see what happens. And it says, there are things that you need to take a look at. I'm just saying, so that thing. Okay, now coming back to the same visualization on top of it. So another thing that Zeppelin exposes is this particular way in which, say you have decided to write a query, but you don't want to essentially modify a query every time. So what you do is you define a variable in this particular sense, and you get this particular kind of input box, and then you can go ahead and say, I don't want to change my query, but I want to see a different result. Which is this? Should have done this before. Okay. So what I was doing is where aged is less than some parameter, and this is the default value. But I could override this with anything else, and then it will execute on the fly. And like there is input, there is a select box as well, and then I change it, and I see different result based on what I have selected over here. Along with that, area chart, line chart, these things, I can possibly export the table that I have over here as CSV or TSV, however I want. So these are some of the basic features that Zeppelin provides you with. What else? Do I have a R example? This is Python. And like I was talking about, there are various other interpreters as well. For example, Flink. If I want to execute something on Flink, I run some of the basic shell interpreter, get some data, short it out, truncate some of the things, and then use Flink interpreter, and then run visualization on top of it, which talks about how our things back with an airline in a backdate, and then a basic demo of Flink, basically. Or use PIG interpreter for simple querying some of the data, and then utilize the basic visualization on top of it, basically. Sorry? With the basic visualization, no, but there are some of the Helium plugins that you can import, and that will allow you to do that. Okay. Right. So if you take a look at this particular button, as soon as you click on it, it hides everything which is related to code. Now, this is the output part of it, if you see. And if you don't want to see much of these things, then there is a view called I want to get into a report view, where I don't see anything but the output. Yes. So let me go back and say, this is my particular notebook, and whoever I want to share it with, I can share it based on a username. Say only user one is allowed to use it, or user two. Same thing goes for who are the people who can write it. Say only these guys have permission to do it, or I can base it on the role, which is this, which was defined back here. I go back to Ambari. So like I was saying, some of the roles that were defined over here, and I can utilize these roles. So once I say this, it will pretty much use this. So now what I say over here is, owner is user one and user two, writer is just user one, reader is, let me remove this guy as well, and reader is user one and user two, which means user two only has permission to read it. He cannot change anything in the notebook. I save this guy, and it gives me a confirmation. Let me log in initially as someone else, say user three, who doesn't have permission at all. So it says that I do not have permission. The allowed user is only user one. You can't come in over here. Now let me change it to say user two and user two. So once I do that, I can get in over here, and then so on. It allows me to take a look based on that, based on these roles that I have defined up here. Also, I can configure the default interpreter binding. So, say I don't want to write every time percent spark before executing any of my Spark interpreter. If I define my default interpreter as Spark, or let me go back to this particular thing. Say I don't want to write sh every time when I want to execute my shell commands. I can go back to my interpreter binding and say, my default interpreter is shell, save it, and now it won't happen. In a similar fashion, if I would have choose to do MDS default, which is the markdown language, and say hash, and just run it, it says this and this. That's it.
Can you name some of the packages you told for drill down? What are the things can we download?
Sorry, I didn't get
it. For drill down capability, can you name some of the packages?
I have to look into the Helium library, but maybe after this session we can check together. And in the Helium library, I'm pretty sure there are a lot of plugins or visualization that are already built in.
Thank you.
Right. So the basic problem with this, the basic reason why we have not implemented all the a lot of graphing over here is, A, it clutters the UI. B, since Zeppelin is an open source and Apache license, we cannot use all possible things because of the licensing issue. And that is why we outsource this thing to Helium, that Helium is not an Apache license, and anyone can write their own visualization on top of it. So if an organization or if an individual user want to use anything based on whatever license that they agree to or so choose to use it or implement it, they can use it via there. And I can take more questions. I mean, I wanted this to be more interactive, but then, or I can have more demo if someone has some specific use case.
Is to create a dashboard with a bunch of visualizations and using that tell a story, right? Typically, that's what we do for our clients and such. Is that going to be possible here?
Yes.
And that's where some of the interactive capability also comes in.
Right. That is possible. Let me see if I have that example. So this is something, okay, sorry, this was an A-line example. Let me leave this. This is something that internally we have used. We have, for bug tracking, we have Jira for us. Jira allows you to export whatever things that are there into a CSV format. So what we do is export all of those Jira into a CSV format, read it over here. Just to check if things are right, I have done a schema check, create a temporary view, and on top of it, we are trying to see how many Jiras are getting filed by our QA internal, and on what version of HDP. So this is just an internal dashboard that I wanted to share, so that I can answer your question that is it possible to build a totally customizable dashboard
Right, but the one that I'm probably talking about is to show, let's say, different cuts, different dimensions for these metrics, right? So I might want to have by geography, by some segments, and then try and look at different other cuts of data, right? So is that like you see a typical Tableau or a Spotfire dashboard, right? You have a bunch of visualizations put together to be able to knit a story together, right? So is that something that you've worked on as well?
For the geography thing, yes, I agree that you are looking for a map kind of a visualization.
Possible. It need not necessarily be...
Right. And it can be anything, right?
Let's say I want to do a trend for each of these segments, right? A line chart, but also next to this pipe, right? So that I can directly relate to it.
Okay. Yes, so you can possibly have multiple visualizations. Sure. Right, so like I was saying, these are the one that we ship, but with Helium library, you can have the possibilities are endless. And to answer your question, let me go back to this particular thing where you have multiple visualizations. Let me click on something, a different dimension, maybe something else. And since this is draggable, you can have this. Or if you want to have these things side by side, you can have it side by side and then go back to report view to visualize these things based on these things. So some of the basic things are possible, but if you're looking for something else, please let me know of the session, and then if it is fairly easy to implement, we can, yes, go ahead. Or
okay,
if you want to contribute, I can help you contribute as well.
Sure.
Right. Yes, yes, it is available here as well. I think I should have something in our... Right. Right. We go down. Yes, those things. And map visualizations. Yes, you can get it, all of those, using the Spark R, or you can use these this thing as Livy as well. Livy.R, and this will also work. So the reason we try to encourage Zeppelin in place of the native Spark or the shell Spark or the you go to shell and do all of these things is because of the operational issues. So to utilize the power of R or PySpark or those things, you need to install certain libraries, and which at time is tricky and not very convenient. Not all of these things get installed very easily. If it fails for some reason, you may end up wasting your entire day. So that is what we don't want customers or any other data scientists to waste their time on. We want them to focus on just a piece of code, get the data right, and if required, visualization. And if you're not happy with this, yes, you can export this data into a CSV format and take it out and use it anywhere else or on your favorite tool. But just focus on, sorry, please.
Prabhushad, one more question. So if, let's say I take a scenario of an end-to-end analytics project that I'm running, right? So I want to import some data, let's say, which is in multiple CSV files. I want to consolidate all of them. I want to do some data cleaning. I want to run a model and finally visualize it.
Right.
Okay. Now, let's say I'm also comfortable with specific I want to use specific languages for each of these steps. Let's say Python for consolidation,
right.
R for a model building, and I like, let's say, Plotly in R for visualization, right? So, or Spark for the model part. So, I'm talking about three different languages.
Right.
So, is it now possible in one notebook to write these three different languages
right.
and do this process end-to-end in Zeppelin?
Right. It is fairly possible. So let me just say percent.
Take over.
Sure.
Now, once I write these codes in different languages, right, are all of these also going to be parallelized?
Yes, it can be.
Okay. So Zeppelin takes care of it. Like I write, let's say, a logistic regression in R, right? But I may not use a parallelized version of logistic regression or a package for it in while I write the code, right? So is Zeppelin going to be able to even parallelize that? Let's say it's just GLM.
Right. So internally, how it works is when this thing gets executed, Zeppelin may not understand directly relation between this val a equal to 10 and then print a equal to 10. What I will further need to do is Zeppelin exposes a context called zz context, which is I can do z dot put whatever my value. I mean, this is my key, which is any string. And then value, which could be this particular val a. And then in a different interpreter, say, come on, show anywhere, okay. I can use same g dot get, same thing. So what I've done over here is I have used the Zeppelin context, which is the Z context, use the same key value pair. So internally it is HashMap. So this is the way you share variables across multiple languages. But then it is not the exact sharing that you might be looking for. But it exposes a way that I understand you have came to point A to point B, but you want to essentially reach to a point D, but without using any other language or a different language, it is not possible for you. So it exposes this particular way, and then you can go ahead with that.
Cool, thanks.
Does it have a facility for integration, enterprise integration? I mean, single sign-on and LDAP connectivity and all this stuff.
Single sign-on is something that we are working right now. But apart from that, what kind of enterprise thing are you?
I mean, the enterprises usually will have their user in an what you call it, an enterprise integration, right?
Okay.
So multiple other application can use the same, you know, username and passwords for the connecting it. That kind of enterprise integration or the single sign-on is possible with Zeppelin?
No, we have not yet built that capability, but okay. Yes, we are working on it.
Okay,
with
thank you.
With Knox, it will be possible, but right now it is not.
Okay.
Sure, please.
Can we have
No. So basically, problem with this particular Zeppelin is it relies heavily on HTML and JavaScript, and given a big notebook, this will require a lot of resource from Chrome or whatever browser that you are running. So now imagine you are running this inside an Ambari view. And if I go back to Ambari itself, you see there are, already a lot of components, and there must be a lot of things that are already pulling on top of it. So we didn't want it to embed this inside that and then end up wasting a lot of resource. And that is why we don't have a Ambari Zeppelin view inside Ambari. Right, so if you're looking for single sign-on, no, that is not there. But then if you're running your Ambari using LDAP or Active Directory, yes, Zeppelin can use the same configuration for that.
Okay. Is there any APIs for Zeppelin? Just can you trigger that notebook from remotely?
Yes.
Okay.
Everything that is possible using WebSockets, okay. Its equivalent is there in REST APIs as well. And if you think they are not working, maybe we can help you out, or like I said, I can help you contribute, or let us know and then we will fix those things.
Definitely, we'll join.
Sure. Yes, this is D3JS. And I can have offline conversation as well, because I see my time is almost. I'm in anyway here, so please feel free to reach out to me, or I work for Hortonworks. Reach me over on LinkedIn, anywhere, Twitter, Facebook, anything is fine.